so going to the question is about cookie, right? So where is my search? I can search about cookies. All cookie, and remember that website? 192. What? This one, right? This is the cookie, right? Remember we set username? Yeah? Remember we set username in there? And I click here, you see the content? I set username to be, what is my username in over here? It's Harley, right? But the cookie is just encrypted to this value. And this value can be decrypted back. Okay? Now, how does it work? It's in the, you know, it's submitted back. Session here is just all inside this block, this content. So last time if you sign in using session, it's also this. And it's just like content and you get decrypted. Okay? Now, everything in session just underscore lab name and then underscore session. Not lab name, app name. You can say, hey, I want to store it to cookies signed username. Everything will work if you just use cookie.signed key username. There's another thing called cookies.encrypted. So what is .signed? A cookies, by default, Rails will say, don't, you know, show this to people, right? Just why, right? Your user should never need to know what you store in your cookie. So let's encrypt it. So cookie.signed mean sign, it used the encryption key, the secret data, secret base from your Rails app. It's in here. If you, there's a secret file, this one, it will use this secret key and then encrypt, right? If you show this key to other people, they'll know how to decrypt from this into your thing. So cookie.signed means prevent, it encrypts this one. And then if you change it or anything, obviously it will not work, right? You cannot change any of this. You cannot change the name. You cannot change the content. Cookie.encrypted is another feature. Do I have it here? Right? So you can set, remember the session, the way you set the session. Today we just learned the session, setting the cookies like this. And you can use this instead. If you use encrypted, then the key here is probably not found, it's not even, you know, be you know, possible to read. So I'm not sure, let's see. I think the key, it will keep this key, but the content will not be, you know, the user cannot even read it if they want to. So let me try, but anyway, that will probably take too long. I think, okay, let's see here. Set a signed cookie, prevent user from tampering means from changing the value, right? Cookie I signed, so if the user change and then it submit, it will detect. Now over here, prevent user from reading the value and tampering the value means on the client side, you cannot even read what is stored in this cookie. So some JavaScript app, like, is very normal, right? Some, let's say you write an Ember app or Angular app or React, it's possible to use JavaScript and say, what is my cookie? This one, I want to read it. So it's possible to decrypt this into the username I just had, if you use the signed method. But if you use the encrypted method, then you cannot. So what does it mean by tampering? Tampering because if I go to localhost, you see this? If you go to the localhost and this is the header, you see the word stat set cookie here? You guys see this one? If I, and what's the other one? 192 dot 168.46. Okay, so it's like this. Now the problem, this session is completely different from the browser. Every browser is different. If I log in, how does it work? Every time you submit back to the server, you actually visiting it, this is you getting back, right? If you post to the server, you can pass in, you know, set cookie or something like that. Your browser is supposed to convert back. If you use your own browser here, you cannot do anything, right? Like the browser keep it and just send the cookie the same back to the server. But if you write your own web, like, you know, script, you can change anything in here. It's like, if you can change some stuff in here, you can pretend to be someone else. Right? So this is the, you know, man in the middle attack. So if Tim submit to the server, so the first, the server say, hey Tim, I know it's you now, all right? Here's the response. And then Tim get this. And inside here, there's a encrypt, you know, there's a value for session, like, you know, username is Tim. Tim send back, but I'm in the middle, I can see it. I take that, and I change that cookie, I go to my app, and I submit. Right? Because I steal your cookie. I steal your session data, like this. I can submit. Now, if I submit that with my information, if the server is stupid, then the server will think that I am Tim. But if the server is smart by using a combination of the data you submit and signing it, so you look, then every time the signature is different. So it's preventing invalid data submission. So it's very small, you know, in terms of prevent user from, both of these is make it safe, prevent user from tampering with the data. But there's something here I haven't checked, which is reading the value. How do you decrypt it? If you Google, you can decrypt the string. There must be a standard, you know, algorithm to decrypt it, if you like to try. Okay? So it's quite easy to understand, right? This cookie stuff, and when you write JavaScript app, you can save some, that's the cookie, but you can also save in local storage. Cookie can only save a little bit, huh? 96 bytes. You cannot store more than that. Yeah?
Then the key has some symbol that are related to the user, but some symbol is random every time the user connects with the server.
I don't understand your question. If every time, yes, a different client accesses the server, it always give you a different cookie back, and then that cookie, you keep that cookie, so I know it's still you, right? There's something between us. Submit that cookie. So if you Google here, see, you say curl, and then you can pass in the cookie. You say, hey, you know, I pass in the token, you can save it back. So normally, if you do curl from the server and then you get this cookie, I can get this cookie and then I, you know, do send back, right? I can post or do something. So it knows that it's still me. It's not a different person, right? So it's like I can pass this back to them. Oh, obviously, I don't know how to run this right now. Okay, well, this curl probably use a different syntax. Maybe set. Oh, there's no equal. Yeah, see, I set back to the user, and then there's and this cookie can, you know, it's kept the same. All right. Okay. So what have we learned about messages? Creating the messages. We know that now we can skip the controller altogether, and we can reuse the view. Okay. We also learned how to write JavaScript like this. It's a little ugly, There are many ways to write it. Where's that? Where's the asset file? Yeah. But I wrote a simple one like this, right? When the text change, you can go like this here. So you see that there are, so far we know three ways to create a new message. Room show. First, you use a form 4 without the remote option, then it submit an HTTP request. If you use form 4 with remote true, it submit an HTTP but as an AJAX, so the page stay the same, and the server return a JavaScript body that you automatically run on your page. Right? The third way we just learned is, how about just basically, instead, you don't need this whole HTTP form. Just create, you know, the enough input. You can use the same field here, and then you just create JavaScript for this text field. And it also gives you the same effect, right? If there's a key up, I check for the what key was pressed. If it's an enter key, then I submit. How you submit it, the three ways are all different, right? The HTTP, you know, JS, the JSON way is not really for submitting, right? It's for getting new messages. And now here's the messages channel. So can you do the same when someone delete the message? What if I go in here and there's a thing here, I can delete someone's message? How does it work, guys?
You can do that on the client side for sure.
So if you go into messages here, if there's a delete button, something like button dot close, you know, delete, like this, let me see, like this, if I click here. So how can you do it? You first, you assign something, a class or an ID. You can say this is like delete message, but you need to know what message to delete, right? Huh? So maybe you say data message ID is what? Message.id, like this? Yeah? So now it's not ID anymore because there's so many delete message buttons. So I just say class here, right? So class. So if you use it for JavaScript, you can just, it's better to just say I will use it for JavaScript only. So I use JS delete message like this. Okay. So what do we do? After TurboLinks load, I get all the JS delete message guy. Okay. On these guys, if you click on them, yeah? If you click on them, then what happened? You can pass in the event here if you want. So if you click on them, then you say, what are you clicking on? Right? Message ID, right, is data, what? Now, notice jQuery, you can do this, attribute, and then you say data message ID. So anything that is an attribute, or you can just do data message ID. So just take out the data part. Is that okay? This is a convention, but this data method can do caching, so you don't have to parse the HTML again and again. So it's a little bit better, but may also cause bugs if you don't write properly. Okay, so I get this message ID. So normally it's a good idea to just say deleting message, you know, ID, and then you pass this message ID in it. Okay, how can you delete this? Huh? App dot messages, remember the channel? What if I can say delete message and then I pass in this message ID? Where is my channel? App JavaScript channel, this thing over here. I create a new method. Now, each of this is a key value, okay? So remember, the second argument is an object. Object in JavaScript is the same as a hash in Ruby. So key, connected. Key, disconnected. Received. You can create more here. Delete message. Function, message ID. All right. In this function, what do? You say perform. What? Maybe you can say, so Ruby, you know, the naming convention is underscore, JavaScript is without, right? So, message, and you can pass message ID. Yeah? So, but it's weird. I think I have to pass a hash, no? We'll see. Right, so I pass in the... Yes, I think normally you have to pass in the hash. But let's just make it crash. So I love error-driven development, right? All right, down here, we create a new function called delete message. Okay, let's call this message ID for now. And let's test a little bit, right? When you click the button, it goes here. I should see in the console. And then it should call this guy over here. And then it will go to the backend. So rails.logger.info, I will call this like, you know, delete message. And then I will just say message ID, like this, yeah? And then just leave it like that, okay? Nothing changes. So remember our tail command? Oh, tail log development, grab delete message, okay. I keep this guy here, all right? I refresh it here, and if I click, uh-oh, it's not working. Why? I go to this guy, I think I didn't save it. Uh-oh, save, refresh. If you really want to make sure this function run, you put a console there. All right, click. Deleting message 98. Deleting message 97. Let's see if they could pass to the server. Where's the server? This is create message. Where's delete message? Uh-oh. It's not showing. Did I print it out? Delete message. I save it. So send to delete message here, right? Let's see, unauthorized, no. Try again. There, cannot execute command because no implicit conversion of blah, blah, blah. Yeah, so I was right that it needs to be a hash, right? Otherwise it doesn't know how to convert the data. So, data has to be a hash. So what do I do here? Delete message. This guy. So maybe I can pass in a hash called message ID. Okay, ID is enough. Okay. So let's try again. It crashed at that. Where's my log? Okay, this is log. One more time. Refresh. Delete message. Okay. Delete. And then I print the Rails log line. Remember? So I have this data. So actually here is actually still only params. Yeah? And how do I get the message, guys? Message equal. Message dot find. Params. ID. Yeah? I think it has to be this ID string. You see, this is ID. I'm not sure if it's smart enough, but we'll see. All right. So let's, and then if I can find it, then I say message.destroy. After it destroy, then it, what should you do? You can broadcast. Now in this case, I see I can broadcast something. What should I broadcast?
Just message deleted.
Yeah, but I am deleting something, but I don't know what I'm deleting. How do I know to remove HTML from the page? V? So I say, huh? Wait, call another function? I just need to pass in a hash. So what is this hash? I can say deleted element, maybe ID. All right. Let me show you guys. What if I call each of this, okay? I put an ID to it, then I can remove it. Yeah? Okay, so deleted, something like this, message.
It can have the same data attribute.
Right, it's harder to find by, so I deleted ID, I'll just pass back this message.id, okay? All right, so I broadcast this. Let's see if it's correct or not. Are you ready? Back to console here. Destroy, please don't delete this. And I broadcast, deleted ID is 98. All right, so I received down here this function. Okay, I'll remove this. This one, I received this here. Remember, if we saw like something like, you know, if I think it's like HTML in data, then you do that. If you know, if I have a key which is like, you know, for example here, data is deleted ID 98, like that, then you say if deleted. How do I check? You know, you can say if data dot deleted ID. Right, and then if it's like, you know, if it's a key that it doesn't know, then it doesn't work. Right, so maybe that's a good way. I believe I should be able to say something in the object, but let's not risk it. Data dot that, yeah. Data dot deleted ID. So what do we do in here? I will find an element. All right, before I get here, I'll redisplay the image. I'll show you guys one trick. In here, you say ID is. Actually, Rails may have removed this method already. I hope not. DOM ID. Okay, so if I refresh this over here, all right, look at these guys, message underscore 99, message underscore 98, right? So message underscore data dot deleted ID, you need to pass in the pound sign and then you can say remove, right? So let's test it over here. Message data, this one I'm just removing for fun. Message, it's not real, right? Oh, it's not there. 99? Okay, it's there, right? And then if I say remove, does it work? All right, it works. So let's remove it. Okay? All right, so click. And it's gone, gone forever. Right, it's deleting. You don't believe me? You will see the SQL statement as well. You see delete 86, so delete the next one, 85, right? It's all really fast. Custom, right? So everything you guys worked so hard for, all these messages are gone. Back to the start of the lecture. No more messages. So what else do we need to implement? Create a message and delete a message. Think about that, okay? Now, when you go home, you can also look at this feature. How did I do this here? I explained very quickly. Appearance a little more difficult. Actually, one more feature you guys forgot is I should only update this in one room. This is actually quite difficult. Maybe let's do that. You can read the appearance stuff later. How can, you know what happened now, right? This is room 10, but there will be other room. How can you do it? This is very hard. How can you do it? Because if you look into these messages, thing here, you see this, where's the room number? How does it know what room? Then there's a channel thing. Over here, I just say every time you enter a message, it should be in room ID 10. That's not good. Mm-hmm. How can we do this? All right. When you load this page, it already joined a channel. Right? Mm-hmm. So I need to pass in over here. Remember I told you guys there are two arguments in creating a subscription. First one is a channel name, and second one is all this extra function you can call. The first argument here, if you just put this, it will just send to a channel name. So I will use the long format. Channel, and I pass in a room ID. So I pass in room ID 10 here. Okay? So that's how you pass in custom. Now you're like, how do I know what room ID it is? Huh? Oh man, this is tricky, right? First, let's pass in room ID 10, and then I'm going to, just now, will be message params, room ID. Okay? So I can do this, room ID, so I just say room ID 10. It's a bit tricky, huh? It's JavaScript, and so room ID. It's like that. So let's look at the create message. Where is it? Okay, just up here. Let's see if it's correct, okay? I go into room, enter, it send, create message, body, guest, action. Where's my room ID? This message, did I save it? Okay, let's try again. Refresh. Now, pay attention. App.messages, room ID 10 here. So if I do app.create, okay, almost done. Oh, where's my room? I'm so mad. Create message params. Okay, this is bad. Channel, let's say if I just make a typo here, I love errors. So obviously nothing get subscribed. Nothing will get deleted. I can just forget about delete, okay. This one here. If I type anything, change, and then it doesn't submit anywhere, right? So correct, so this seems good. So if I do that, this now, it's just going to wrong channel. It doesn't exist. So if you notice, I do this, there's no connected, disconnected. So you know something is wrong. If you change it back to channel, and then run this, then there's the connected here, okay? I need to troubleshoot why this room ID is not shown up. Action table overview. And channel, client side, here, passing parameter to channel. Okay, so there's a subscribe, when you subscribe, there's a params in there. So room here, in subscribe here, you can pass in rails.logger.info params. I will do param.inspect, okay? So, subscribe. My Rails log is so crazy, so I'm gonna create. Oh, look at this. Oh, room ID is here. Yeah. Weird, huh? All right. In this case, it works over here. I'm not sure. That's a bit crazy. Okay. Log development, grab, subscribe. refresh room ID 10. Yeah? So I have the room ID, and then you can create. Down here, you can find information. If I press create, let's see. Create up here. Not sure. I think it's under the identifier. Yeah, so it's not under this data. So I'm showing data, body, username, action here. This is this data. It's under identifier. So there are a few ways to do this. So so you can get this not from message params, but under, let's do this. Params. Let's see, huh? Params. I hope it's still params. Yeah, I believe so. Try. Ready? Reload. Display params. Here. Right? Params, channel, and room ID. So it means I can use here. Room ID is params, room ID. Make sense? Now the question is, how do I pass in this room ID? This is quite difficult. The way to do it is in your room show. You have a room ID somewhere. So in here, I know room ID. So when I set up for the list of messages over here. So I say ID is, class here, JS setup room. And then data room ID is what? Room ID, right? My room name, room ID here. Okay, so these messages set up room. Let's see the parent. You have You have a room ID here, room ID 10 here, set up room here. So in your channel, in your messages channel. Don't run this right away. Messages. This one? Everything in here? Don't run it right away. Set up a function. Call setup room message, right? Messages. And then you room ID. And this is a function. Like this. So JavaScript, there are many ways to write functions. I just use this. Create this global variable called setup room messages. Put everything inside like this. Okay, so it's inside room. And then you put in here as room ID is room ID. Does it make sense? So what if I reload this entire browser? Nothing get connected. Yeah? But if I do set up room messages and pass in 10 to it, then this is now connected. And then it will start working again. So I want this to, when do I want to run this function? In room.js, remember the turbo links load? So you go down here, add one more function. Call for all the guys that has the class set up room, right? For all the guys that have this. Each one of them, you use each in, there's an index here, you don't, each one of them, then there's a room ID, right? So then now you can call, your global setup room messages for that room ID. So then, it's connected again. Yeah? You don't believe me? You can write here log, set up for room ID is room ID. Only now you will actually have it the code work for any room. Okay, you can create another room like Ruby room set up for room 11 and then your messages over there will not come here. Okay?
Why not make a separate channel for each room?
Yes, correct. So I have to do that actually. Right now, you good point. I need to pass in one more thing under channel. Okay, so it's not a channel. The code is the same, so you have to use the same channel. But the stream is different. So now, everyone is subscribing from this room ID thing.
You stream from different rooms.
Because otherwise you guys can still come to my room. Because they're all streaming to the same place. Because I pass in the room here, so I can use program's room ID to decide what stream to use. And then I can use program's room ID here to decide what message to use. So it's a bit tricky, right? Because I don't want to run the main tricky thing is that JavaScript file asset, JavaScript channel messages. And look at this. You're like, oh, I can do this. You put it in a function, don't call it yet. Right? After you render and you know the room ID, then you call just JavaScript. Okay?